Hey, it's Fran again in the lab. I want to do a video about a topic that is near and dear to my heart. It's my love affair with the light-emitting diode. I'm not, by any stretch of the imagination, an authority on LEDs. There are several vloggers on YouTube who are experts in LEDs and have lots of really cool vlogs about exactly how they work and how they're constructed and how they're made and all that stuff, blah, blah. I'm not the authority, but I am the biggest fan of LEDs. And this goes back, like, to the Stone Age. I first encountered LEDs in the early 70s, and one of my first electronic possessions was an LED calculator. It's this Novus 650 math box. Got this calculator as a gift from my grandparents in 1976. And this was absolutely the most mind-bogglingly amazing thing that I'd ever seen or used. And the Novus actually is kind of revolutionary in a lot of ways in that it was one of the very first real pocket calculators that a regular person could afford. It was also revolutionary in that the entire calculator is just on one potted chip, which is sort of visible inside of the... I don't know if I can get the lighting in here, but... Let's see, you could sort of... Yeah, I could sort of see it in there. That little black smudge. That is it's like about the size of like a half-inch square squidge of potting, and underneath of that is a pair of little microchips that are just cemented right to a PC board that goes right to the LED display. There's really nothing in here to see electronically, which is something that added to its mystery. It really was just literally a black box. But the math box was amazing because it had an LED display. I'm going to fire it up. But these early LEDs were all very small. The earliest LEDs were quite literally microscopic, and you needed lenses to bring them up to any kind of scale that you could actually identify with your eye. And the math box, let me turn it on, there you go. Oh, look at this, see? Yeah. Unfortunately, this calculator, you go to EE. This calculator is so simple. Now, any calculator on a transistor level is not simple. There's thousands of transistors in here, but the number of registers was so limited that they actually don't really even have like any kind of debouncing for the switches. So it tends to double up keys a lot if you're not really quick with selecting the keys. You can get 77777 if you tap the button the wrong way. No debouncing, but this was my sort of introduction to the LED, and I started collecting LEDs way back when. And so I realized that I should do a vlog about this because I've got some very rare and early LEDs. In fact, I've got like four big boxes of LEDs sitting around me right now that I'm going to fish through and show you sort of the history of LEDs through my collection. And the early LEDs were all, like I said, small and dim. The very first LEDs, solid-state light, light-emitting diodes, they really emerged from, quite literally, laser technology, because it was actually the pursuit of a solid-state laser that produced the first gallium arsenide LEDs, and they were all the old red 660 nanometer light red LEDs. The first ones, though, were very expensive and really just laboratory curiosities, because in the 1960s, LEDs were just too dim, too small, and too expensive to really be put in any kind of product. But in the early days, when they were first making light-emitting diode dyes, they came in lots of kind of weird configurations and presentations, and one of them, these are some of the very first LEDs that were ever available. They're unmarked, but my research just online, which I'll put some links in the description for some cool sites on LEDs, but they mentioned that these are probably made by Monsanto, one of the very first LEDs that was really made in any kind of quantity was the Monsanto MV1, and this LED has that MV1 dye in it. But the case is unusual in that it's got a single kind of long lead. The cathode is the little tail, and the anode is sort of a little cup that's underneath of a lens. And I guess the idea was this was supposed to be soldered into a PC board, but as I'm going to show you, these were really just too dim to be used as indicators. I really think that they were more or less just laboratory curiosities, just to demonstrate the wonder that was solid-state light. So, I'm going to put it into a breadboard. I've got the light stop down so that we don't get the glare. And I'm going to put some current to the anode, and there you go. Look at that. Little red dot. It's kind of on the camera a little orange, but it really is pure red. There you go. The miracle of a light-emitting diode. First one. So, this is the next rarest LED. This was the first really commercially available LED. And it's made by Fairchild. It's called the FLV-100. And it's pretty much universally agreed among people that this was really, like, quote-unquote, the first LED that people really met. And again, very dim, but you know, you see the beginnings of the kind of the traditional LED case with the lens and the dye inside. And you know, this is kind of the gateway to the more modern case styles that would come up, the T1¾ being the most popular size. Once again, very dim, but see the light there, and the dye is a little off-center. It's very faint. I'm going to give it a little more current. That's about it. Overall, it's probably about the same brightness as that the MV1 Monsanto, but with the lens, it just sort of diffuses it, spreads it out a little bit more. So it's a larger dot, but it's dimmer. So these, you know, were used, and they were cheap enough to be put into consumer electronics. Yeah, so here you go. That's the early, late 60s, early 70s LED right there. Yeah. FLV-100. Here's another early one, new in box, and this is interesting because it's a miniature case, but it's got a lens on it. It's got the two leads on one side. Kind of looks like a modern LED. It says here it's a Monsanto MV5080. Unsure exactly when this would be made. There's no date code, is an early one, and hey, let's just ruin the value of this by tearing this one open and seeing what it looks like. Some power to it. Oh, here we go. Gonna break the seal. Broke the seal. Go. It's a clear lens. So let's Ooh. Oh, look at that. Ooh. Nice. So tiny. There you go. Broken out of the box. Used for the first time. Late 60s era. Early 70s, maybe. Monsanto. The red LEDs are all gallium arsenide phosphide, and they all made exactly the same wavelength of light. And I've got lots of early red LEDs. I could spend hours just going through all of them. But really, what people really wanted was different colors. And here's an orange mid-70s LED. And they found that by putting impurities into the actual LED material, that they could alter the wavelength of the light. And the impurities, it's called doping. Or they were putting dopants into the actual semiconductor, and they found that by putting these impurities in and varying the gap spacing and such, that they could change the actual wavelength of light. This is actually one that I bought new, probably, I don't know, 77 or so. So exactly when it was made, I have no idea, but it's before then. And here's an interesting thing. This is an orange case, you can see, right? So you go and you order this, and you buy it in a store like the Radio Shack or the Heath Kit, and say, wow, orange LED, I'm so excited. I can't wait to put this in my project. An orange LED, that's going to look so cool. But wait, when you actually power it up, it's got a red LED dye in there. It's just a red dye. Look at that. Total chip. You got the, it's like, yeah, you know, you got the case and all, but when you actually turn it on, it's red. It's a red LED. So, you know, if you know your optics at all, you know that if you have a light that's of a very specific wavelength, it's only one wavelength of light, and you put a filtered lens on it, well, you don't change the light at all, you just get a dimmer light. So it's just a dimmer red inside of an orange case. But this is very typical. I used to have a green LED that had a red dye in it, just like this. It was a kind of an emerald, dark emerald green case. And when I'd fired it up, it had the red LED in it. I thought, oh, what a jip. I threw it out, which was really stupid because I really wish I had that stupid red LED in a green case now, but this is just an example of some of the tomfoolery that was going on back in the mid-70s. Here's a little board that's actually just come right out of my bin. I put this together, oh geez, when I was a kid. Hence the kid-level soldering on the bottom of the board. But it has two interesting LEDs in it. Obviously I've made this as an indicator. But these are mid-70s LEDs, and it's got a real orange and a real green. And these are kind of cool because this orange, this is a real doped orange. I'm going to put some power to it. I can show you the color here. Yeah. So you see it's a yellow, I guess it's a yellow dye in an orange case. Again, not quite orangish, but not exactly quite yellow either. Kind of interesting. Again, it's a, you know, an early orangish yellow doped LED. And the interesting thing too is this green one, because as I found out on the internet, that the Western Electric company, they made telephones for Bell. I guess it really was the same company, Bell and Western Electric, but they invented a green LED in the 70s that was very popular, and it's kind of unusual color. It's not like the late 70s and 80s greens. Show you here. See the? It's a very emerald green. I don't know if it really shows up on the camera the way I'm seeing it, but it is a very, it's almost like a key lime pie green, like an eerie phosphorus green. It's not like the very neutral, middle-of-the-road green LEDs that you would see today, or even from the 80s. It is sort of an eerie green. You can actually see the dye in there, on the bottom, the clear lens. So that's but I saw on the internet the unusual green Western Electric dye, and I'm willing to bet that that's a Western Electric dye in there. I don't know who made the LED, but that's probably Western Electric green dye from the early 70s. I'm not kidding about how many LEDs I have. This is just my 1960s bag of LEDs. So you can get an idea of just, you know, I could keep going through this bag, but they're all red, so, you know. But I do want to move on to some other cool things, such as, these are some old calculator displays, you know. They're all, let's see. And they're all sequenced, you know. You would have oh, here we go. There's one with a clear lens, an old calculator. Oh yeah, look at that. Oh, look at that beauty. It's just a work of art. Look at that. Oh, you can see the transfer wires there. Oh, it just really is just beautiful. Yeah. Great. Here's some these are the very first 7-segment displays. I'll pull out a few here to look at. Here's a Monsanto Man 5 in the box, new in box. I also have one unboxed here. This is one out of the box. Yeah, this is what they were like. It's obviously a molded case that's been, it's a double shot, what they call it, double shot process. See, it's actually a solid molded case that's been in black, and then the light pipes there for the LEDs are, it's a second molding, where it's kind of just filled in with sort of a reddish, orangish, clearish light pipe, and then the actual LEDs are in the back. Oh, look at that. Beauty. It's very pretty. Definitely a work of art. So here we've got the Man 5 wired up. Some 1K resistors. A 9-volt battery. Oh, there you go. Nice. Very nice. So there you go. The Man 5. One of the first. Here's some other cool 7-segments. It's this little guy here, this little bugged one. I don't know if I can get a good shot of this with this lens, but yeah. Can you see the light shining through? You can see the 7-segment display. This is a tiny one. See if this one will light up. Ooh, there we go. There's that little guy going. Clearly I have the display upside down because the decimal is up on the upper left, but yeah. So it's actually a matrix of tiny little, even smaller LEDs. Looks like there's maybe 4 of them per segment. Tiny, tiny little diodes in there, all kind of chained together. And that's really the close-up of that larger segmented display. They all, each segment is actually several LEDs, not just one, you know, but you can see how small they are. Really small. And just get some scale of the size of that number. Again, there's my finger. Really practical for display purposes, as you can tell. So, yeah. But, cool. Here's another multiple display in a DIP package, curiously enough. It's a four-digit, seven segment. And again, this would be, this would be sequenced. So, you know, you would attach the pins for the seven segments, and then there'd be a pin for each of the segment for each of the digits, and so you would have to have a clock working to turn each one on individually and do it fast enough, and you get persistence of vision. And you know, that's how these multiple digit seven segment displays worked. But this is a really cool one. This one is ultra super cool. It's again, it's a DIP package. We got gold pins. Oh, but look at this. Oh, look at this. It's so pretty. Look at that. This one, I really want to get this one on the breadboard and fire it up. It's just such an attractive. It's a single segment, single digit. Sorry, it's a single digit, seven segment. But look at that. Ah, oh, gotta turn this one on. Well, I stand corrected. This is something very interesting. I'll dim this down a little bit. Can see there that it's actually, I have one lead connected, and it's actually got two segments on. And if I connect to this lead, mix up plus, see? So it's plus or minus. Yeah, minus. See, plus or minus. Minus, plus. Minus, plus. And then I got this one over here. And it looks like it'll form a 1. One plus, or plus one. Again, I'm probably looking at this upside down. Probably. And a little more. So there's a couple more pins here. Oh, there's the period. Okay. Yeah, it's upside down. There we go. All right, so that's a plus one. So, or it's a minus one. Plus one, minus one, plus one, minus one. Here's another beauty. Got a lot of these, and these are again an early red seven segment, and they're totally covered in a ruby red case. You can't see the segments when it's off, which is sort of cool. I really like the sort of extended block style too. So obviously it's blockish like this because, like the Man 5, it's got light pipes in there to diffuse the LED dyes would be in the back, and then there'd be these long light pipes which would diffuse the light, because again, it's each segment is many LEDs, as we've seen in the tiny ones. There's actually maybe four or five little LED diodes making up each segment, and the long light pipes make it so that the actual light seems like it's just one light, but it's many lights. But these are really cool because they're sort of mysterious the way that they're all potted. So I'm gonna turn this one on, although I can't see the traces on the inside, so it's going to be some guesswork which one is the common anode. Oh, there you go. It's pretty cool. The lead spacing is so tight I can't actually put it in the center of the breadboard. It's only 200 mil spacing, so I've actually got it bugged the other way, but yeah, one of the segments isn't working. or at least it's not making connection. Might be tarnished pins, but there you go. That's pretty cool. Kind of mysterious, you know, because it doesn't really show, you know, it's like, oh, what is that? What is that? Is that some kind of, what? Oh, it's an A. Oh, ooh, hey, where'd it go? It's an A. Where'd it go? That's pretty cool. It's mysterious. I really dig these mysterious displays. There you go. Ooh. 7-segment, or, well, or 6-segment in this case. This is an early 80s dual display, and you really see the difference in the construction. A lot more segments. It's got the plus and minus in each digit, and it's even like flippable. And cool too is the potting is transparent in the back, so you can actually see, you know, these metal segments in there that transfer the current from the pins to the dies that are actually cemented on the top side and wired in. And those are very, very close together. It's just a very interesting construction method, the way that those are all kind of laid in there, and allows you also to see where the common traces are for each segment, whether it's common anode or common cathode. And there's really no standard. You know, some of these LEDs are common anode, some are common cathode. You just sort of have to try it one way and then try it the other way, and you'll figure it out. In the early days, there really was no standard. This is pretty cool. This is a larger block, like that smaller one. It's the same type, it's just a larger display. It's kind of interesting. You can actually kind of see the 7 segments in this one. The lens isn't quite as dark. I would guess that the lens isn't quite as dark because it's probably got the same number of actual LED diodes in there, and so it's probably a lot dimmer. But I'm not going to wire it up, but it's just interesting. All right, so these, you know, red and yellow and green LEDs pretty much were all you had forever. In the 70s, it was gallium arsenide phosphide, and then in the 80s, they started using a new kind of LED. It was called indium gallium aluminum phosphide. Dare you to say that 4 times real fast, but it made for much brighter LEDs, and you still just had yellow and green and red with some combinations of dopants that were sort of like orangish, reddish, or greenish yellowish that were sort of in between the two. And so, but you couldn't make white light with just that combination of colors. You really needed blue, and blue was really hard. I mean, the first blue LEDs really to be available for hobby or even for displays really didn't come out until the 90s. And the modern, So this is like a bag of typical, these are modern eye-gap blue LEDs, and there's a few hundred of them in here. But these are pretty ubiquitous. I mean, everyone's used these. They're super bright. They're actually it's actually a UV dye. It actually creates UV light. And then there's a phosphor in there, an organic phosphor layer that gets stimulated by the ultraviolet and then puts out the light. So this kind of eye gap LED is used for just about every color these days. They all start out as UV light, a very bright UV dye, and then depending on the color of the phosphor, it creates different color light. And this is the kind of LED they use for blue, white, and pretty much any color of the rainbow in between these days. But these didn't come out until like the late 90s, maybe 99, 2000. These kinds of phosphor LEDs started coming out. But before then, there was this. Still got some left. These are the first blue LEDs, and these are just so expensive when they came out. Unlike the the UV with the phosphor, these actually create a blue light directly. And they're based on silicon carbide. These weren't made for very long because they were very expensive to make. And they're expensive to buy. I was paying, I think, close to $10 a piece when these first came out. And they do make an unusual blue light, though, as we'll see. So you can see the dye in there. It's kind of, there you go. It's hard to, you probably won't be able to see what I'm saying, but it's sort of an odd blue. It's not, like I said, these are really dim. It's sort of a watery, pale blue. It doesn't have the purplish sort of overtones that the, it's sort of a cyan. It doesn't have the purplish overtones that the iGap LEDs have, but yeah, I put these in the, in some of my pedals in the late 90s, and they were really something. But they didn't make them for very long. Okay, and which leads to these. These are the last LEDs I'm going to show, because these are my favorite LEDs out of my collection, and they are, by my standards, the weirdest LEDs I've ever found. These are, show a close-up here. I'm going to get one out of the bag. Let's see. It's a TO92 transistor case, three leads, gold leads, no less. It's a TO92, but this is actually a visible LED. It's just so wild, and it's really just, oh, there we go. Look at this. You can see the elements in there and everything. Look. And it's a transistor LED. It's just so cool. Oh, look at that. So cool. Let's turn it on. Well, the wild thing about this is that, contrary to what I would think, they don't actually have the LED die on the flat side. It's actually on the rounded side. I guess in some kind of attempt to have that be like a lens, but it's such a tiny LED in there. Look at that. It's like the same size dot in one of those micro calculator displays. So small. That is such a weird idea. I can't imagine what this was used for. I mean, it's so small, it's so dim. It's just so weird. I don't know. I don't know, maybe if it was meant to be put onto a circuit board for, like, some kind of, like, an testing indicator for testing, like, large boards or something, so that you just kind of fire it up or what, but it's just, it's weird and interesting. I mean, gold-plated leads and everything. Well, whoever thought this thing up, whoever made it, they sure put a lot of love into it. And you just can't beat that with a stick. So yeah, it's just some of my collection of LEDs. I got like boxes and boxes of LEDs, like flat ones like that, vintage. Here you get your ubiquitous, HP, like bags of these HP sort of early gallium arsenide phosphide greens, kind of pretty and dim. But anyway, that's a little bit into my obsession about LEDs. They're really cool, especially the earlier ones, and it just makes me realize that, when you're feeling down and life seems pointless, that in truth, happiness is a 10-pound bag of 7-segment LEDs. Please so happy. Me want to cry. I'm Fran. I'll see you back at the lab. Bye.